to learn the good, the bad, and the reality of the nomadic lifestyle, click the subscribe button so you don't miss anything. Click the bell notification. So there's this big event every year out in the Nevada desert, BLM, called the Burning Man. It's gotten so big now that the BLM is actually trying to put a lot of restrictions on the event. They give out a permit each year. Right now, they give out a permit for 80,000 people to attend this event. And it's just a big party, a celebration of freedom, and just a good time. But one of the things they're trying to do, they're trying to get it where the Burning Man has to hire their own security force and screen participants coming into the Burning Man. Because the BLM says it's federal land and we do not allow our narcotics into the BLM. Well, here's this big party, they're bringing in their narcotics. So the Burning Man has really been trying to straighten up their act, getting things straight, making sure the trash is picked up, making sure that the town doesn't have to deal with the trash. That was one of the big complaints, was trash was being taken out to the town and dumped in dumpsters, and now the town has to deal with all that trash. There may be a time when the Burning Man will not be able to comply with all the rules. Well, sure enough, there's another strike in the books for the Burning Man this year. It seems like, you know, the last few years someone has died during the event. Well, so the Burning Man promised that everything would get better this year. Well, there was a man in his van. Some attendees of the Burning Man noticed that he was unconscious or whatever, and they commenced CPR and called an ambulance. Well, of course, the ambulance got there. They took him to the medical tent. They assumed that it was going to be carbon monoxide poisoning, so they took him and had some tests done. Sure enough, it was carbon monoxide poisoning. After further analysis, they also discovered there was narcotics in his bloodstream as well. Now, I know I just did a video about carbon monoxide poisoning, but I've learned a lot even since then. Carbon monoxide is a very serious problem for campers. You Google it and you'll just see a list of people who have a problem with carbon monoxide while camping. I think what happens is when we come out here camping, we're out here to have a good time, and we're not thinking about all the safety measures that we have to think about. So one of the things that obviously is being impaired. Impairment causes you not to make good decisions, or you just simply pass out. And so a while back I made one about a couple who fell asleep in their cargo trailer. They brought a generator inside and they started up and they died from carbon monoxide. Well, again, a lot of people in the comment section, including myself, well, why would you bring the generator into the cargo van? Well, you know, I had an assumption that maybe there was some impairment going on, but I don't want to say that because there was no evidence of it. Well, here we have evidence of it. So here, today is a good example. It's very cold here. It's, I think, in the mid-30s. Of course, you're running your heater. Propane heater is what we have. And propane produces carbon monoxide. Anything that burns a flame from a natural source, such as propane or natural gas or gasoline, wood, if you burn wood, it all can produce carbon monoxide. So carbon monoxide will get into your bloodstream. So you breathe it in, and just like oxygen, it attaches itself to the red blood cells. And so now you have a red blood cell that has taken on carbon monoxide. So now the red blood cell cannot take any more oxygen. Well, here's where things even get worse. Is if your carbon monoxide detector goes off, and so now you have inhaled carbon monoxide, it attaches to your red blood cell, and it can take up to 4 to 6 hours to even half the amount of the carbon monoxide that you've taken in. So here's the important thing, is once your carbon monoxide detector goes off or you feel the symptoms of carbon monoxide, you're going to need to keep yourself oxygenated for 4 to 6 hours so you don't get sick. Or if you go to the hospital, they may be able to accelerate that with an oxygen mask. Now, what I am understanding is the illegal substance also caused the body to slow down. And so it wasn't even producing the amount of oxygen it needed already. So this amplified the problem. Now, what it's going to feel like, it's going to feel like that you're suffocating when you start taking in carbon monoxide. You're going to get a headache. You'll probably get nauseous. You're going to get sleepy. Chances are that if you feel these symptoms while you're sleeping, you might wake up and be able to, this feels like carbon monoxide poisoning. You'll be able to go outside and start getting some fresh air. But now when you're intoxicated or impaired, you may not wake up and say, oh, I'm suffocating. Carolyn and I have had to deal with carbon monoxide. It just happened to us the other day, as a matter of fact. Just the other day, I was cooking a pot of coffee, had the windows closed. Now, normally when I cook a pot of coffee, this is not a big deal. I don't understand why it happened to us, but it did. And it happens. You know, I don't open the windows every time, and we're in and out during the day, so it doesn't really accumulate too fast. And our carbon monoxide detector went off. And so, you know, you turn on the fan, you open up the windows, you open the door, and it takes a good 15 minutes for that place to air out. I don't understand why it takes so long, but it takes a long time. Now, my suspicions are what happened was the flame was not blue. We're up here in higher elevations. Of course, again, this is the first time it's happened to us, just, you know, making coffee. But up here in higher elevations, the flame does not get as much oxygen. So if you have a yellow flame, the yellow flame is telling you that you're producing more carbon monoxide. That means the yellow flame on your propane stove is not burning efficiently. If it's blue, it's burning efficiently. It's still producing carbon monoxide, but at very small amounts. And most of the time, you can ventilate that very easily. Opening the door, you know, Carolyn and I go to the bathroom or whatever, the door opens and it ventilates. But I've noticed up here in the higher elevations, the flame turns a little bit greenish, kind of in between the blue and the yellow. So I'm thinking it's not burning very efficiently when it's burning this green flame. Now, I have two carbon monoxide detectors, and I put one at the foot of my bed. Last time I made a video, I said they were both over my head. They're actually, one's over at the foot of my bed, and one's over the head of my bed at the same height. Now, I know a lot of people think that carbon is heavier than air. I looked at a science paper, and it's not. It's lighter than air. So carbon monoxide just floats all around. So my opinion, having a carbon monoxide just above my nose level while I'm sleeping, you know, if I'm breathing it and carbon monoxide detector goes off, then I know that, okay, I'm consuming carbon monoxide. I put the other one at the other end of the bed. Now, here's what's interesting. I've never had both of them go off at the same time. My guess is if we open the door or something, the breeze comes in, it pushes it to one carbon monoxide detector or the other. Hope that enlightened you on some safety measures for carbon monoxide. So thanks for watching. Like video, and happy travels.